God's been faithful. this is just the beginning.
I don't know what God has in store for you, but this is just the beginning. Hold on to your dream.
I just wanna praise him. I just wanna praise him.
praise him. I just want to praise him. I want to praise him in the morning time. I want to praise him in the noonday. I want to praise him in the early afternoon. I want to praise him when the sun goes down. I want to praise him in the evening hours. I want to praise him at nighttime. I want to praise him in the midnight. The Bible says weeping may endure for a nighttime, but if you praise him, if you praise him and hold to God's unchanging hand, oh, somebody praise.
Praise.
It was the prophet said, in the year King Uzziah died, but I saw the Lord. He was sitting on a lofty throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Attending him were mighty seraphim, each having 6 wings. With 2 wings they covered their faces, with 2 they covered their feet, and with 2 they flew. They were calling out to each other, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of heaven's armies. The whole earth is filled with his glory. Their voices shook the temple to its foundation, and the entire building was filled with smoke. Then I said, it's all over. I'm doomed, for I am a sinful man. I have filthy lips, and I live among a people with filthy lips. Yet I have seen the King, the Lord of heaven's armies. Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a burning coal he had taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. He touched my lips with it and said, see, this coal has touched your lips. Now your guilt is removed and your sins are forgiven. All right. Then I heard the Lord asking, whom should I send as a messenger to this people? Who will go for us? And I heard Resurrection Life respond. I heard the Village of Hope respond. I heard the believers respond, here am I. Send me. The word of God for the people of God. Somebody ought to say thanks be to God. Can I hear somebody say, yes, Lord? Can I get somebody to say, yes, Lord?
Yes, Lord.
Can we all together just throw our heads back and say, yes! Lord. Yes, Lord. Won't you pray with me? Lord God, we come at this appointed hour, humbly seeking your face. Lord, we present ourselves right now, not as a blameless people, not as a faultless people, but we come pleading guilty to our sins and transgressions. And we place ourselves at the foot of the cross, and we humbly seek your mercy. Father, by the power of your grace, we ask now that you anoint us with your free gift of salvation. Lord, now as you send this word, we ask you to open up the ears, the hearts, and the souls of those who are gathered here, Father, so that as the preacher is decreased, Lord, you be increased. Receive us now as we wait in our respective places, yielded and still. Lord, have your way. Use us how it pleases you. Have your way, Father, for you are the potter. We are the clay. Lift up this mighty word a word for your people. And Lord, we'll be so careful that we stop worship, praise, give you the glory and the honor and all the praise, because you're worthy. Have your way right now. It is in your mighty, majestic, and marvelous name we pray. And in the matchless name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. 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 Yes. Lord. Pastor, Bishop, Pastor, Reverend, to the ministerial staff, the officers, members, Resurrection Life, to all who come out today to be a part of this anniversary celebration, I especially want to lift up and to thank God, praise God for our Village of Hope family. Praise God for your obedience to the Holy Spirit. And as the Holy Spirit guided us and directed us this morning, that we were in a place where we needed to be someplace else. And I want to thank you that you didn't tarry asking questions, but as the Holy Spirit provided direction, you responded obediently. And we praise God that here we are, safely in the presence of the Lord and God's people. And so, as you might recall from our Bible study series, God will give you the strength to press forward. And as we have examined Paul's letter to the church at Philippi, it is one thing to sit around and identify what all the issues and problems are. It's another thing to undergo a spiritual checkup and examine oneself and then ask not who is the problem, but am I the problem? And if I am, then Lord, fix me so that I will become a part of the solution. Anybody in here know the potter can fix it? Well, if you don't know, then just take a look at yourself in the mirror. And you've been fixed by the potter. But you know, that's a message for another day. We're going to celebrate the anniversary of Resurrection Life as we witness that, yes, God is good and his mercy endures forever. If you don't believe that, just take a look around. And everywhere you look, there is God's handiwork. Bishop Barrett is God's handiwork. Amen. Pastor Kathy Barrett is God's handiwork. Yes. All of us are God's handiwork. Yes. Chris is God's handiwork. Yes. And you know, the common denominator that you will find in each of them, and all of us who acknowledge that we are servants of the Lord, you will acknowledge that at some point in time, we heard the call of the Holy Spirit, and at some point in time, we said, yes, yes, Lord. We didn't give him the Noah kind of response where we tried to debate and figure out, is it me? Are you sure you want me? We didn't give him the Abraham kind of response. Lord, where are you asking me to go? We didn't give him the Moses kind of response. We didn't give him the Esther kind of response. But we gave him the response of the prophet Isaiah in chapter 6 of the book Isaiah. In verse 8, when he said, yes, Lord, here am I. Send me. And you know, that's where we find ourselves today in the life of the church. The theme, this is just the beginning, means that in order for that beginning to happen, you have to say, yes, Lord. You have to present yourself as a holy living sacrifice. A living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto the Lord. In order for us to say, yes, Lord, we have to acknowledge that we are, I am, you are a person of unclean lips. I am a man of unclean lips. You have to be willing to acknowledge that I have been in the midst of people with unclean lips. Oh, aren't you thankful that we serve a living God who said, cast your cares and all your sins and all your burdens and all your troubles, bring them unto me. It's time now. It's time for the church to move from an audience to an army and become the leaders that God has brought us here to be. You see Resurrection Life and VOH and other houses of worship that are here. In 2014, it ought to be clear to us that God wants us to step up, step out, and lead. Step out on a limb. It's time to lead. If you're in the classroom, you should be making the best grades. If you are a single or married woman, you should be leading by living a high standard and setting a high standard for other women and young women. If you are a single or married man, you should be lifting high the standard for what it means to be a child of God, because it's time to step up and lead and say yes. Somebody ought to say yes, Lord. Somebody else said, I know where he's headed. And so, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. And as we explore what the Bible says about how we should learn to lead, I want to call your attention to the scripture text that I shared with you just a minute ago in chapter 6 in the book of Isaiah. It is important that we learn to lead, because at this point in our history, God is calling us to lead, and we've got to be on the right agenda. We've got to learn to play the right key. I don't care how gifted you are as a musician. I don't care how gifted you are with your voice and with your preaching and all those other things that we tend to lift up and that we tend to give that praise to. I'm telling you right now that God is calling us to lead, and we got to learn to lead. As Isaiah said, clean me up, get me ready. I may not be worthy, but get me ready and Send me, Lord. Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? Charles, who will go for us? And I said, here am I. Send me. Somebody say, here am I, Lord. Here am I, Lord. Here am I, Lord. Here am I, Lord. Now tell your neighbor, friend. Friend. Lord, look at somebody. Don't be looking at me. Look at somebody and call your friend. Now look at him. Don't be patronizing me. When I say look at a friend, look at somebody. And if you don't like who you sit next to, look at somebody else. And if you don't like them, look at somebody else. And if you don't like them, get up and find somebody that you like and look at them and say yes. You want to be cute, you need to go home. And so if you don't want to sweat, you don't want to look at somebody else because you think you all that in a bag of chips. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Because when you say yes, Lord, when you say yes, Lord, when you say yes, Lord, you become what? Highly. All right, you don't want to be highly favored, that's on you. But I'm going to say yes, Lord. I'm going to say yes, Lord. If these bifocals fall off my face, I'm going to say yes, Lord. If my knees begin to buckle, I'm going to say yes, Lord. If this old shoulder brace starts to slip out of place, I'm still going to say yes, Lord. Because when you say yes, Lord, you're highly favored. Oh, it's going to get good in here this afternoon. It's going to get good in here this afternoon. I might even preach this to myself. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Now, let me borrow your ear for a minute. Because in order for us to not repeat the mistakes we've made in history, we have to do what? Understand that history. And the church has made some mistakes over the course of its history. And we've done some good things, but we've also made some mistakes. But let me just, if you will, share with you for a few minutes. As we look back on America's history and the history of the Christian faith, and we find what amounts to two strange bedfellows. Now, however strange a relationship may seem, the two are bonded at the shoulders, and no matter how the politically correct might try to write the Christian faith out of American history, using the guise of separation of church and state, how can you separate God from that which God created? The next time somebody suggests to you that there ought to be a separation of church and state, you need to ask them, wait a minute, who created? It wasn't John Boehner. It wasn't Harry Reid. It wasn't Nancy Pelosi. It ain't Lindsey Graham. is not Tim Scott, but God. Anybody know him? The one who said, let there be light. The one who said, let us mold man into our own image. That's who I'm talking about. The one who said, who picked up the dust and molded it into our image. And he blew into the nostrils of that mold the breath of life. And then he ordained it by saying, as he said, with everything else he made, that what? That is good. But you know, folk try to write things and folk will take scripture and do whatever they believe they want to do with it. There are whole denominations that have been formed based on one person's interpretation of scripture. But you better be careful. Some folk will take you to hell, drop you off, and come back for the next busload. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
In fact, what makes America great is the church of the Lord. So when one studies the roots of American history, one finds that the church was there at its worst and at its best. At its worst, the church condoned the abuse and displacement of Native Americans, otherwise called Indians. At its worst, the church approved and blessed and even profited from slavery. At its worst, the church looked the other way when children were forced to work in coal mines and died at an early age from abuse at the hands of millionaires and the magnates during the early part of the 18th century. At its worst, the church was there. But the church was also there at its best. Just read the Declaration of Independence and see what it says about how all men, women, and children are created equal and given certain unalienable rights by who? By God himself. When you look at the history of education in America, we see that throughout the years, many of our schools were founded on Christian principles intended to develop strong Christian ministries and to develop strong men and women in the church who were educated at its best. When we study America at its best, the church is always there. When we look at America at its best, the church, whether we're talking about the first and second great awakenings, which had spiritual, economic, and cultural importance for this land, or whether one is talking about the civil rights movement of the 1950s and 60s, which were birthed in the churches of the South and North, the church. Somebody ought to say, the church's been there.
The
church's been there. And when Jesus said, on this rock, I shall build my church and the gates of hell, nor the hell raisers shall prevail against it. Oh, somebody ought to say amen. Praise the Lord. Can somebody tell me, go ahead and preach. I'm going to do it anyhow. When the church participated in the worst of American history, it was asleep. It was a sleeping church lost in darkness. When the church at its worst participated in that which was oppressive and kept people down, it was when the church was in disagreement with the word, the will, and the way of God. And it is important that we remember that disagreement leads to darkness. Darkness leads to a church that is asleep. And a sleeping church is a church without power. Somebody say, we got some power. We got some power. We got some power. Because we're in agreement. Now touch somebody. Touch somebody. Touch somebody. Because there's power in agreement. There's power in agreement. But look at what happened with the church at its best. And it participated in good and great things in American history. It was a church that was in agreement with the word the will and the way of God. And when you come into agreement with God, God will release power in your life so that ordinary people can do what? Extraordinary thing. There is power. There's power in agreement. Here's what Jesus said in his word, that where there are two or more gathered in my name, and where they touch and agree, he said, he stands in the midst, and whatever you ask in his name, we shall receive, because he will provide. You see, there's power in agreement. An agreement leads to an awakened church. And an awakened church is a church, what? Filled with the Holy Ghost power. Somebody say, we got power. Even if the power goes out, we got what? We got power. And when the church is in agreement with God and becomes an awakened church filled with power, it becomes a church that causes a divine disturbance. It causes unrest. It causes discomfort. It causes anxiety. And it causes uneasiness. Remember that James Brown song when he said, I got ants in my pants and I need to dance. Well, today we need to get some ants in our pants and get our praise on and dance like David and get involved with Jesus. Jeremiah said, there's something going on deep down inside. It's like fire. Oh, shut up. Oh! Oh, help me somebody. You see, that is the kind of church that came out of the Isuzu Street Revival of the early 1900s. It was a movement that I've enjoyed studying because it tells a compelling story about a one-eyed Baptist preacher from Arkansas by the name of Charles Harrison Mason, founder of the Church of God in Christ, which started out as a collection of storefront holy rollers who were the laughing stock of the religious community and became the second largest African-American denomination in the world. Bishop Mason went to Los Angeles in 1903 looking for a fresh anointing. You talk about a fresh beginning. He went there looking for a fresh anointing. And God blessed him with an anointing. And God laid on his spirit a phrase. And it became a phrase that was a resounding theme with Bishop Mason. He never delivered a message that he didn't include this phrase. He said, yes, Lord. He said, yes, Lord. He said, yes, Lord. He said, yes, Lord. Can I get somebody in here right now who will say, yes, Lord? You don't even have to look at nobody. Just say, yes. And using that one phrase as his foundation, Bishop Mason went on to build the largest African-American Pentecostal church in the world by saying, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord. One phrase, a commitment to God by saying, yes, Lord. And that church we all laughed at, that church we all mocked and called it all kinds of names because they didn't have a big fancy building, is now growing at a rate that sets all the other denominations to shame because they learned to say yes, to say yes, Lord. And if Resurrection Life is going to grow. If VOH is going to grow in the church of our Lord, is going to grow spiritually and bring lost souls into the kingdom, we're going to have to learn to say yes, yes, Lord. Because you see, when we learn to say yes, Lord, God will do extraordinary things in the lives of ordinary people like you and me. That might not sound like much to you, those of us who stop and think about our ancestors and how they did so much for so many with so little. We got to know it was only by the grace of God, because somebody in our family, Grandmama Mim, had sense enough to say, yes, Lord, yes, Lord. When they were being mistreated, they said, yes, Lord. When they were being talked about, they said, yes, Lord. When dogs were being sicked on them, they said, yes, Lord. When the fire hoses were turned on them, they said, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. You see, the little bit that we have is not because of anything we've done, but it's because God has looked upon us with favor. Because Mama Nim prayed and said, Lord, look after my child. They said, Lord, have mercy on my child. Lord, they said, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. And today God is looking for churches, Resurrection Life, Village of Hope, First Nazareth, Brookland, Bible Way, Shandon Baptist, Shandon United Methodist, you name it. God is looking for churches. God is calling on churches, men and women, boys and girls, people from all walks of life who are willing to say,
yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
But it may not take away your burdens or your tribulations, but it will make it easier to live with the burdens, because God doesn't always remove the obstacle. God doesn't always remove the thorn, but God's grace, His grace, His grace is, somebody wave your hand and say, His grace is sufficient. He didn't remove the thorn from Paul's flesh, but He reminded him that in his weakness, God said, I am strong, and my grace is sufficient. If you want to be delivered, if you want to be relieved from the burdens that are weighing you down, then you got to come to an agreement. You got to learn how to say, yes, Lord. When we say, yes, Lord, God will turn your burdens into blessings. He will turn that breakdown into a breakthrough. And that test will become a testimony. That's why the songwriter declared, I am Somebody say, I am a living testimony. I should have been dead and gone, but I thank the Lord. He let me live on because I learned to say yes, Lord. When you learn to say yes, Lord, the Lord will handle that which was about to cause you to lose your mind. He will bring light where there was darkness. When you say yes, Lord, He will heal your broken heart. When you say yes, Lord, He will make a way out of no way. God is looking for somebody who knows how to say yes, Lord. Somebody who knows how to say yes, Lord. Look at somebody next to you and say yes, Lord. Throw back your head, throw up your arms, act like you just don't care, and say yes, Lord. You see, when you say yes, Lord, you're saying that we'll be content where we are, instead of wishing you could be somewhere else. We're saying we will do what God calls us to do. We're saying that we will trust in the Lord until we die. We're saying that we will obey God's will. We're saying that we will open up our hearts and our hands with joyous generosity and joyous love. When you say yes, Lord, we're saying, Lord, I'm yours. Do with me what you will right here, right now, in this place. Use me, Lord. When we say yes, Lord, when we say yes, Lord, we say, Lord, you are the potter. I am the clay. Oh, listen to Abraham. When he said, yes, Lord, Noah said, yes, Lord. Moses said, yes, Lord. Esther said, yes, Lord. Nehemiah said, yes, Lord. The widow at Zarephath said, yes, Lord. Jeremiah said, yes, Lord. Daniel said, yes, Lord. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said, yes, Lord. Mary, the mother of Jesus, said, yes, Lord. John the Baptist said, yes, Lord. And can't you hear Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane when he said, Father, take this cup from my hand, but if not, your will be done. Can't you hear Jesus when he said, yes, Lord, yes, Lord. And because he said, yes, Lord, he dragged that old rugged cross to a place called Golgotha, where he was hung high and stretched wide between two thieves. And he looked toward the heaven and he said, Father, into your hand I commend my spirit. Jesus was saying,
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Is there somebody here right now who knows who I'm talking about? If you don't know, let me throw you a hint. Let me give you a clue. I'm talking about Jesus. I'm talking about the Rose of Sharon. I'm talking about the Lily of the Valley. I'm talking about the bright and morning star. I'm talking about my shelter in a time of storm. He's my friend when I'm friendless. He's my battle axe. He's my rock, my sword, and my shield. They called him Wonderful. They called him Mighty Counselor. He is the Prince of Peace, the Everlasting Father, the Mighty God, standing at the door to your heart. Don't you hear him knocking and waiting for you to say, or don't you hear him knocking and waiting for you to say, don't you hear him knocking and waiting for you to say, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord. He is my healer, the great physician. He's Redeemer and Lord. When I think of my God, who can bring treasures out of trash, who can make jewels out of junk, who can bring glory out of garbage, who can make worship in the midst of waste, who can bring majesty through mess, who can bring deliverance to the drug addict. He can bring praise to a prostitute, healing to the sick. I'm talking about King Jesus. I'm talking about King Jesus. Yes, they hung him high. Yes, they stretched him wide. Yes, they buried him in a borrowed tomb. Yes, he stayed there Friday night. Yes, he stayed there Saturday night. But it seemed like sometime early Sunday morning, he said, yes, Lord, it was time to get up. It was time to get up. And so he got up from the grave with all. I said he got up with all power in his hand. And because he lives, I can face tomorrow, because I know who holds the future. All you gotta do is say, yes, Lord. All you gotta do is call him by his name.